So we just finished an entire year going verse by verse through Revelation, and specifically focusing on the second coming of Christ. And so I think it's appropriate that now, as we're finishing off Revelation, we are entering into Advent, again, focusing on Christ's coming. And so I wanted to look at this a little bit different. Typically, we just go through Advent and we celebrate Christ's coming and looking forward to his return. But I want to look at what we're to be doing as we're waiting on his return. What is the posture that we are to have as we are eagerly anticipating his arrival, his coming? Amen. And so I just want to say we're not sitting here just biding our time, twiddling our thumbs, counting the days, looking for those clouds to part. There's, we have an obligation, we have purpose as we're waiting. Amen? And so I, amen, there is work to do. Not that we are earning our way, but in the meantime, we are, there is work to be done. And so I think that as Christians, it's often thought of that once we say that sinner's prayer, that's it. It's a one and done. We've sort of uttered this magical incantation, and that has granted us access into the kingdom of God. No, that is categorically false. That is the beginning. When you surrender your life to Christ, that is exactly what you have done. It's no longer yours. You've given it to him, and he begins to shape and mold it as he sees fit, so that you will become the person that he's always destined you to be. This is, we'll talk more about this, this process of sanctification, the Holy Spirit changing and molding, perfecting you to his image. Amen? And so I think a good way to explain that, you know, men, every man, I was always told, every man needs to have at least one good suit. You have that one good suit. And when you got that one good suit, you get it tailor-fitted to you, and it's all nice, and you look sharp when you put it on. When you want to look good, you put that suit on. And then, but as time goes by, you go to put that suit on, and you start to say, hey, wait a minute, there's something wrong with this thing. You know, you blame the dry cleaners. You know, you shrunk my suit. The weather, it's a little humid out here. And we blame everybody else, and we want to take it back to the tailor and say, hey, can you do something with this? It's not, what the work that you put in on it, it didn't last. And they'll look at us and they'll say, well, you know, you just need to buy yourself another suit, because no amount of tailoring I can do is going to fit you into this thing. But this is the opposite of what God is doing with us. When he puts his righteousness upon us, he's not trimming and tailor-fitting the righteousness. He's tailor-fitting you. He begins to shape and mold you so that as you have that righteousness of Christ, you begin to fit into it. And it takes time. It doesn't happen overnight. Amen? So I thought a good way to start off this season of Advent would be looking at the church in Corinth. I think there's no other church in that Paul is writing to that gives such elaborate, you know, he gets into some really a wide variety of issues. It's a very troubled church here in Corinth. And just to give you some background of what's going on and on this church in Corinth, Paul, he founded this church, I think, on his second missionary trip there in Corinth. And initially he went in and he was preaching to the Jews. And they rejected it. And it was there that he said, well, from now on, I'll go to the Gentiles. And so he founded this church here. And just give you some understanding about Corinth. It's a very relatively young city. It was a very culturally diverse city. It was the city was destroyed, I think, in about 146 B.C. And then, I think, in around 100 years later, Julius Caesar, he reestablished it, looking at that there was considerable advantages to where it was positioned for trade. And so he repopulated the city with military veterans, with freed slaves, all types of laborers and skilled tradesmen, repopulated this city, and it was a sort of a financial hub. It had two ports, one facing going directly into Asia, the other going into Italy. So there was a lot of commerce flowing through there. And it was an opportunity for those that were poor to really make a living for themselves. It was, you know, capitalism at its very best. The market was wide open for them to make a living. And so it was also deeply rooted in paganism. You know, it was a Roman culture, so it was deeply rooted in paganism. All kinds of sexual immorality. There was a lot of sports fanatics there. It sounds a little similar to what we're dealing with today. But the thing is, and this was the issue, the church, being there, you'd wonder, how could they function and maintain their light in such a place? This would be an ideal place for them to shine the light of Christ in all of this madness. And that's the problem. They didn't. Instead of influencing the culture influenced it. And this is the problem that we have today. We allow the culture around us, society, to influence the church, the ideals of this world to seep into the church. When we are called out of this world, we're in it, but we're not of it. And so we have a whole nother perspective that we are living in. And I consider it an abomination when we allow what's in the world to seep into the church. And it seems to be so prevalent today that we don't even notice it. But when you stand on this word, you see it for what it really is. It needs to come out. We are set apart, called out for his holy purposes. Amen? So we're going to look at this today. And just the opening verses, I think knowing some of the issues that Paul is going to discuss in this entire letter, it informs what we can read into the opening of this letter. He's addressing in this letter all kinds of issues. There's sexual immorality, incest. They're partaking of the Lord's Supper in an unworthy manner, defaming it, defiling the house of God. They're just a little bit of everything. A wide variety of things that they have allowed the culture to influence it. And here Paul is addressing them. So it's written here in verse 1. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church in God of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. Grace and peace to you from God, our Father, and the Lord Jesus Christ. So, I'll look at verse 1 here. It says, our brother Sosthenes. I don't know if you remember Sosthenes. He, in Acts, I think it's Acts 18, where Paul is, he goes into the temple, and he preaches the gospel. They put him out. Well, that first temple ruler, he believes the gospel. And so here we have this Sosthenes. He's sort of promoted, I'm assuming, to being the temple leader. And so the Jews, they did not like this, I would imagine. They're pretty offended by this. And so they have Sosthenes. He becomes the new temple leader. If this is the same one, I don't see why it shouldn't be. But he goes before the proconsul and begins to make his case against Paul, saying that he's preaching this gospel. And this proconsul Gallio, he's like, "What is this? Has nothing to do with anything that I want to hear." And so he dismisses the case. And the Jews, they're so infuriated at this, they turn on Sosthenes and they throw him a beating. They beat him down right there in front of the proconsul, and he didn't do anything about it. It was as if he took pleasure in it. And so here we have him saying, writing to this church in Corinth, where Sosthenes was beaten, he's saying, our brother Sosthenes is here with me. And so the implication is that he converted to the faith, just as the first ruler of the temple converted. And so sometimes it takes a beating for us to get it, you know? Sometimes we don't get it the first time. I'm sure he heard the gospel when the first synagogue leader heard the gospel and rejected it. But it took him getting a beating, perhaps, for him to sort of make sense of this. Well, if y'all are going to beat me and I'm doing what you called me to do, maybe there's some validity to this, what Paul is talking about. And, you know, for some of us, we need that. For some of us, we need to learn a lesson the hard way. And I'm talking from experience. You know, I grew up in the church and I didn't get it. It took somewhat of a beating for me to really grasp hold of the gospel, to say, you know, I'm trying things my way, you know, and it didn't seem to be working out. You know, maybe I ought to heed this word of God that was handed down to me. You know, my grandfather used to tell me, a hard head makes for a very soft behind. And that was a lesson I learned quite often. You know, just couldn't quite, talking, he would say, talking doesn't do you any good. It just goes over your head. You don't understand. You're not an audible learner. You're, what is it called, a kinesthetic learner. You have to learn by action and interaction. And so that's how they taught me growing up. And at some point, I just figured, I said, you know, this isn't working out for me. This is too hard. I'm learning things the hard way. There's got to be another way. And so sometimes we need to learn some lessons the hard way, but it doesn't necessarily have to be that way. And so if you are find yourselves in situations where it's a bit difficult too often, you feel yourself sort of experiencing some hardship and you're wondering why. Why am I continuing to experience things this way? Why am I learning these lessons the hard way? I've gone through it. Okay, God, I see what you're saying. Why did I have to learn it this way? Perhaps you didn't listen the first time. It's an opportunity for us to look at ourselves and to wonder, well, am I not listening? As Paul, he says, you are eagerly anticipating the second coming of Christ. Are we eagerly listening? Are we eagerly learning these lessons the first time? Because if you find yourself being in difficult situations far too often, something's wrong. There's a disconnect somewhere. As we saw, this was avoidable. If this is the same Sosthenes, I believe it is, that was beaten there, if he would have just listened the first time. It says, to the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people. I want to talk about this today, this sanctification and holy. They go hand in hand. I want to make up a word. If you don't really understand sanctification, it means to be, to me, easiest way to understand is to be holified. It's a verb. It's something that the Holy Spirit is doing to you to bring you into that holiness. Because remember, he's given you his righteousness. And so now you're not just walking around with his righteousness, he's called you to conform to it. And so this is the process of sanctification. He sets you apart, sets you aside, takes you out of this world and sets you aside, sets you on solid ground and begins to mold and shape you to being who he's called you to be for a purpose. There's a purpose for you being sanctified. He's going to use you for his glory's sake. Amen. When we get to the kingdom, when he comes back, we know there's not going to, this is why we're being sanctified, because we're going to be with him. We went through Revelations. We talked all about this. We will be with God. He will be with us. We will be in his presence. And so the process starts now. I think often we think of heaven as, okay, well, I've said the sinner's prayer and I'm good. So now I'm just waiting on God to take me to heaven. And when I get there, that's when everything will be made right. But we've already become sanctified. We've already been set apart. So the process has already begun. If you've accepted Christ in your life, if you have surrendered your life to Jesus Christ, you have already begun this process of being molded and shaped into his holiness. Does that make sense? It's already begun. We're not waiting, just waiting, twiddling our thumbs for this to happen. It's here and now. We've already been set apart. And the flip side of this is that, you know, we often, you know, God bless them. I probably would have been one of them. You know, we stand out on the corner as Christians and we have these signs, turn or burn. You need to repent. Tell unbelievers this. You need to repent so you can be saved. And that's not right. Because you cannot repent unless you've first been set apart. We've called out ourselves. At some point in your life, you said, I can't do this by myself. I cannot save myself. You know, I'm struggling with some issues that I can't seem to get over. And you needed to cry out to someone to convict you, to set you apart, and to begin to shape you in his righteousness. You have to first be set apart. Telling someone to repent, they can stop what they're doing. They're just going to do something else. They need a savior. They need one to set them apart to begin this process. And then the Holy Spirit within them begins to work and to shape and mold and remove that baggage, remove what is unholy. You understand that? Believe and repent. That is what our message is. They first must believe. And receiving power from on high, he begins to shape and mold you. And I know there's many of us that we've been struggling with some things for a long time. Things that we feel that, you know, I've been putting this in your hands, God, and I just can't seem to break free of this. Whatever it may be, know that God's grace is sufficient. If you've given it to him, his grace is sufficient. Amen. But you have to first be set apart. He sets you apart and he does the work inside of you. Amen. In verse 4 it reads, I always thank God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. Knowing what Paul is going to address, knowing all that he's going to talk to this church about, what he's writing about, I just kind of get the sense that this church is perhaps, when they're reading this opening letter, it's typical, his typical opening. But I just get the sense that they're sweating a little bit because they know the mess that they're in. They know what they've been doing. And as he's writing this, it seems like he's flattering them, but he's saying, no, this is what you should be doing. This is what ought to be. And when he says, I think God for you because of his grace given you. I hear a whole nother thing because he's like, I know, I've heard the stories. There's things that you've been doing that even the pagans look down upon. You're sinning on a whole nother level. I thank God for the grace that he has. I see God's, the extent of God's grace with you because what you are doing, how you are living, he should have wiped you out a long time ago. I thank God for the grace given to you. Amen. And he goes on to remind him that, you know, they've been endowed with all of these gifts. They're not lacking anything. Though they were sinning on a whole nother level, they were endowed with all these spiritual gifts. It says they weren't lacking in any of the spiritual gifts. In verse 5, it reads, for in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge, God thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. They were well equipped. They had all the spiritual gifts that they would ever need. I could just imagine serving in a church like that, trying to pastor a church where there's just the gifts. All the gifts that there are, all of them, everyone, gifted with the Spirit. I mean, that could be perhaps one's dream pastorship or one's nightmare. The nightmare, I don't know. But they weren't lacking anything. God provided for them all that they need. Living in this society that they were in, they were well equipped to deal with it. He didn't just leave them to fend for themselves. They were well equipped to deal with it, and they failed. They were allowing the culture to influence them on a level that exceeded those that were lost. And you wonder, how is that? How can one that is well equipped with all these spiritual gifts, how can they be living in such a way? Paul founded this church. They had the gospel. They were instructed well in this gospel. So how could such a church, how could there be people be living in such a way, having the Spirit of God in them, set apart, and yet still be living in such a way. It doesn't make any sense. And the only sense that I can try to, the only thing I can think of to try to understand is that they were living contrary to that sanctification. God had pulled them out of this mess that they were in, and they went right back in it. And we do that. We do that as Christians. God has pulled us out of this world, and we go right back in it. We can't help ourselves. We're waiting for Christ to return, and we say, well, you're not coming. We're twiddling our thumbs. You're still not coming. Oh, well, I guess I'm just here. And then we find our way back into the world. We allow the world to influence us. We're not eagerly anticipating his coming, his arrival. And so we get complacent and we wander back into the world and we allow ideologies, cultural views to intermingle into what has been sanctified. And then we bring that back into the church. And then as the church, we begin to propagate it, and it just begins and it just turns into something abominable. He's sanctified us. He's pulled us out of this world. We're not of it. We're in it, but we're not of it. And so everything of the world, there shouldn't be any of that in you. If it's not Bible, if it's not the Word of God, it has no place in you. Because when you allow the world to influence you and then you bring that into the church, you defile the church because it's not in the Scripture. It's not God-breathed. It's not useful for teaching and rebuking. And we bring this into the church. We are acting contrary to the sanctification of the Holy Spirit. We're kicking against the goats. We're fighting against God. That is all that is. As he's pulled us out, stay out of it. Stay out of the world. Stay into that sanctification. Allow him to continue to shape and mold you as he's called you to be. Amen? There's a disconnect somewhere where we just begin to roam back to the way we came, back in the mess that he's pulled us out of. We're called to be the light. To be the light to this world, to influence the culture. With all the issues going on, all that's going on, you pick any issue that society is dealing right now, Scripture speaks to it. And we fail to influence culture in a biblical perspective. We allow the world to influence us, and we allow the world to influence how we read Scripture rather than how we teach and preach to the world. Walk in this light. We are sanctified for a purpose, amen? It's written. In verse 8 it reads, it says, he will also keep you firm to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Firm until the end. He will keep you firm. He says he will keep you firm until the end. This is the word teleos. It means to bring something to its completion, to bring something to full maturity. I mean, many will read this and think of this in a temporal sense that, okay, he's going to keep us firm until he returns. We can read it that way, but I see it speaking to something else as well. He will keep you firm as he is bringing about this work in you to completion. This word teleos, it's the same word as Christ utters. It's the root of teleste. When he was on the cross, he called out, teleste, it is finished. It has been brought to completion, paid in full. The work has been completed. There's nothing else to do. There's nothing you can add to it. It's finished. And here he's saying that he will keep you firm until the work in you that the Holy Spirit is working in you is brought to completion. If you just stand firm in him, don't go back into the world. Stay in that sanctification as we are waiting on Christ's return. Eagerly, we are eagerly anticipating his arrival. Stay in this sanctification. Do not wander back into the world. He's pulled you out of it. You can't pull yourself out. He did. And as you are standing in this sanctification, he will keep you firm in it. And so we understand that there's nothing in this world that can move us out of his hands unless we ourselves move out of it. So when we find ourselves back in the world, it's not because the world done it. You did it. You did it. You made the conscious decision somewhere along the line to go back to the same mess that you called out for help for. As the scripture tells us, a dog will return to his own vomit. And that's what we do. We go back into the world. No, God has called us, sanctified us to live in this righteousness. And he will keep you firm until the very end. You don't have to worry about what's going on in the world. You don't have to worry about the wars that are going on. I know there was a pandemic. I know there are wars. I know there's rumors of wars. I know that there's the gas is sky high. I know health insurance is out of control. Everything is just a mess. But he said, I will keep you firm until I bring this work in you to completion. Don't waver. Don't look at what's going on around you and start to shake and shimmer and go back in the world thinking that you're going to fix something. Stand firm on him. Amen. His word is his bond. You can take it to the bank. He said it. I will keep you firm until the very end. So as we are waiting, eagerly waiting, I think that would be the key word in this passage. Eager. We are eagerly anticipating the coming of our Lord. Stand firm. He's going to bring this work to completion. That is the work of the Holy Spirit. You're not doing it. He is. Just stand firm, stand still. Be still. You know, you go to the barber and get to cut your hair. He said, be still. I don't need you to do nothing. Just don't move. I got this. You start moving, you get nicked, and you look like a fool coming out of the barbershop. Stand firm in what he's brought you into. Amen. Let us pray. Father, I thank you for this word. I thank you for this reminder as we are eagerly anticipating your arrival. May we just be firm in you, trusting that you will keep us firm, that you will keep us solid. As you are performing this work in us, you will bring it to completion in your way, in your time, in your manner. May we not linger back into the world, linger back into the mess that you called us out of, that you pulled us out of. Again, we thank you. We couldn't do this ourselves, because we are lost ourselves. And of our own self, we'd be right back in the mess. And that's often what we do. And so, Lord, I just pray, may your grace continue to abound in our lives. Have mercy on us, Lord, and just continue to strengthen us so that we would trust in you to just keep us firm, Lord. We take you at your word. And we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.